Thank you for tuning in to the City of Orlando's virtual POW-MIA Recognition Ceremony. My name is Priscilla Kalajan, and I serve as the chair of Mayor Buddy Dyer's Veterans Advisory Council. Each year on National POW-MIA Day, our council hosts a recognition event at City Hall to honor and remember current and former prisoners of war and the more than 82,000 servicemen and women who remain missing in action. Although we are unable to gather in person this year, we hope that today's virtual program will bring some comfort and hope to military families who are still waiting to be reunited with their loved ones. Now we will hear a special message from our mayor, Buddy Dyer.
Hello, everyone. Priscilla, thank you for your warm introduction, and thank you to all of the members of our Veterans Advisory Council for your hard work and dedication. We are blessed to live among heroes, willing to sacrifice their freedom to protect our own. In times of war, we make a sacred promise to those who wear our country's uniform. Part of that promise is that if they fall on the battlefield, we will not leave them behind. Still today, there are 82,000 men and women of our armed forces who remain missing. We must do everything in our power to find them, fulfilling our promise of bringing them home with honor and dignity. All of our city commissioners join me as we recognize this important day, a day to renew our promise to those heroes who send themselves into peril to keep us from harm. Today, we renew our pledge to never forget. In honor of this special day, I'd like to share with you the following City of Orlando proclamation. Whereas brave American service members have sacrificed their lives to preserve our country and protect the democratic ideals that make our nation a beacon of hope, and whereas we honor those Americans who suffered unthinkable hardship as prisoners of war and recognize them for their courage and determination, and whereas we also honor those who remain unaccounted for, especially remembering the sacrifices of their families who must courageously face each day without knowing the fate of their loved ones, and whereas the POW-MIA flag flies at City Hall as a powerful reminder that we promise to honor those who selflessly served our country, and whereas September 18, 2020 has been recognized as a day to pay tribute to those heroes and their brave sacrifices, which serve to remind us that freedom is not free. Now, therefore, I, Buddy Dyer, Mayor of the City of Orlando, do hereby proclaim September 18, 2020 as POW-MIA Recognition Day in the City of Orlando, and call upon all residents to join me in honoring our former prisoners of war and in renewing our commitment to those still missing in action that will bring them home. It is my hope that today's virtual ceremony, performed by the cadets of Air Force ROTC Detachment 159 from the University of Central Florida, will bring some peace to the families of those still missing in action and deserved recognition to all of those who are former prisoners of war. Next, Priscilla has some incredible stories of local former POWs to share with us.
Thank you, Mayor. Today, I am honored to tell the stories of two former prisoners of war who both call Central Florida home, Second Lieutenant Edward Izbicki and Colonel Joe Kittinger. Their stories of bravery, patriotism, and perseverance are inspirational and powerful, and are a somber reminder of the sacrifices our armed forces make in service to our country. Edward Izbicki is a veteran of World War II, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War. He was an Army Staff Sergeant when he served in World War II for 2 years in Europe. After leaving the Army, Ed graduated from Wright Junior College. In 1951, Ed passed the initial pilot training exam, joined the U.S. Air Force. He graduated from pilot training 1 year later in April of 1952 and headed to Korea in the fall, joining the 336th Fighter Inceptor Squadron. It was on February 19, 1953, during his 26th mission, that Ed's aircraft was shot down near the Yalu River. He was wounded and forced to bail out at 21,000 feet. Seconds after he landed, Ed was in custody of two North Korean guards and turned over to the Chinese. After 64 days of interrogation, he was transferred to another camp for yet another 54 days of questioning. Ed refused to make admissions, and after a combined 118 days of interrogation, he was read a proclamation sentencing him to 100 years as a war criminal. Ed was placed in a cell 5 feet long, 4 feet wide, and 4 feet tall. He was unable to stand up straight in the cell. During his time in his cell, Ed grew lonesome for the Stars and Stripes. He borrowed a needle from a guard under the pretext of mending his uniform and started to make a flag. The flag was made of white bedsheets, his blue prisoner of war uniform, and red shorts. Ed had nearly finished stitching on the stars made from American soap wrappers when he was forced to destroy it. Ed persisted and began making a second flag, which was finished in time to smuggle it over the camp's lines. After returning from Korea, Ed spent 4 years at the Air Defense Command out of Madison, Wisconsin. He was then transferred to Stead Air Force Base in Reno, Nevada, where he taught survival training for 6 years. It was in Reno that he met Sylvia Sue McCarthy, whom he married in 1958. Sue was also a veteran Navy and Air Force flight nurse. After Reno, Ed headed to Albany, Georgia to serve with the Strategic Air Command, flying KC-135 jets. In 1967, Ed was transferred to McCoy Air Force Base here in Orlando and retired from the Air Force in 1969, settling in Castleberry. After his military retirement, Ed worked for the U.S. Postal Service and NASA for many years until his full retirement in 1992. Ed and Sue raised 3 children, Anne, who is since deceased, Andrew, and Grace. They also have 2 grandsons, Drew and Kyle. Ed and Sue were life partners until her death in 2014. Ed selflessly cared for his wife through a decade-long battle with dementia. Ed recently made the decision to move into assisted living in Lake Mary and is enjoying a very active lifestyle, including the leadership of a local group of former POWs. Colonel Joe Kittinger is a veteran of the Vietnam War, serving 3 combat tours and flying a total of 483 combat missions. In March 1949, Colonel Kittinger entered the U.S. Air Force as an aviation cadet, completing his training 1 year later. He was subsequently assigned to the 86th Fighter Bomber Wing based at Ramstein Air Base in West Germany, flying the F-84 Thunderjet and the F-86 Sabre. In 1954, he was transferred to the Air Force Missile Development Center at Holloman Air Force Base in New Mexico, where he flew the chase plane that monitored Colonel Joe Strapp's rocket sled runs. Colonel Kittinger was next assigned to the Aerospace Medical Research Laboratories at Wright-Patterson Air Base in Dayton, Ohio, where he made a series of 3 extreme altitude parachute jumps, his final jump from 102,800 feet in the air. The records Colonel Kittinger held for his parachute jump stood for 52 years. After completing another high-altitude balloon project at Holloman Air Force Base, Colonel Kittinger returned to the Operational Air Force for 3 tours to Vietnam. During his voluntary 3rd tour in 1971, he commanded the 555th Tactical Fighter Squadron, flying the F-4D Phantom II, where he was credited with shooting down a North Vietnamese MiG-21. Colonel Kittinger was shot down on May 11, 1972, just before the end of his 3rd tour. While leading a flight of Phantoms with his weapons systems officer, First Lieutenant William Reich, they were engaged by a flight of enemy MiG-21 fighters. Colonel Kittinger's plane was hit by a missile that damaged the Phantom's starboard wing and set the aircraft on fire. They ejected and upon landing were captured and taken to the city of Hanoi. Colonel Kittinger spent 11 months as a prisoner of war at Ho Lao Prison, also known as the Hanoi Hilton, where he was tortured by guards. He was very serious about maintaining military structure while surviving his time at the POW camp, and was the senior ranking officer among the newer POWs that were captured. On March 28, 1973, Colonel Kittinger was returned to American hands. Following his return, he attended the Air War College at Maxwell Air Force Base in Alabama. Then Colonel Kittinger became the vice commander of the 48th Tactical Fighter Wing at Royal Air Force Lackenheath in the UK. Finally, in 1977, he transferred to Bergstrom Air Force Base in Texas, retiring from the Air Force 1 year later. After his military retirement, Colonel Kittinger went on to set even more world records, this time for the first solo balloon crossing of the Atlantic in 1984. In 1992, Colonel Joe Kittinger Park was completed by the Greater Orlando Aviation Authority for the City of Orlando and named in his honor. In 1997, he was inducted into the National Aviation Hall of Fame in Dayton, Ohio. Finally, in 2014, a restored F-4 Phantom II aircraft was added, painted with the colors and markings of Colonel Kittinger's squadron in the Vietnam War. At this time, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Ms. Debbie Barry. Debbie is a Gold Star sister whose brother served in Vietnam and remains missing in action. She is a tireless advocate for veterans and is part of our Greater Orlando community.
Mayor Dyer, members of the Advisory Council, ladies and gentlemen, I am truly, truly humbled to virtually stand before you to share my remarks as we remember and honor our nation's prisoners of war and our missing in action, those who never return to the loving arms of their family and friends. Across the communities and our country, folks pause to remember. For a moment, we share deep sorrow and a feeling of loss. We renew our commitment to country, and we vow to never forget those missing in action, and we pray for the return of our POWs so that they are with their families, so that they experience closure and can find a sense of peace. POW-MIA Recognition Day is commemorated on the third Friday of every September and came about initially from families of Vietnam POWs and MIAs demanding accountability. National POW-MIA Recognition Day is not a public holiday. We go about our normal days to the extent we can right now with COVID, right? We engage in work, possibly going to school, going to the grocery store, maybe for recreation we play golf. But many, such as yourselves, take time to pause and remember the sacrifices and the service of our POWs, our MIAs, and their families. Someone I greatly respect recently said that mine is a story to be told, and today I will share a small glimpse of that story with you. I am a Gold Star family member born to a military family. My father retired after bravely serving in the United States Air Force for 20 years. My oldest brother served in Vietnam as an Army aviator, and that is where today's remarks stem from. I was only 7 when my brother's helicopter went down, and decades have passed. The heartbreak still exists, and I often wish I could pick up the phone to ask for brotherly advice and learn from his sage wisdom. I wonder what decisions I would have made differently, and I ask myself if he would be proud of the person his baby sister became. I have with me the journal that my mother kept, which contains the Western Union telegrams we received in 1968. Yes, you heard me, old-fashioned telegrams. Over 50 years have now passed, and this is, to the best of my knowledge, the first time that this telegram and this journal have been outside of my immediate family. So bear with me. Dated 1968, January 12th. Don't phone, don't deliver between 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. My father's name is wrong, incorrect middle initial, but that was no cause for hope because the home address was correct. Let me read the rest of the telegram to you. The Secretary of the Army has asked me to express his deep regret that your son, Warrant Officer Paul L. Berry, has been missing in Vietnam since 10 January 1968. He was last seen as pilot of military aircraft on combat assault mission when aircraft lost power, crashed, and burned. Search is in progress. You will be advised promptly when further information is received. In order to protect any information that might be used to your son's detriment, your cooperation is requested in making public-only information concerning his name, rank, service number, and date of birth. This confirms personal notification made by a representative of the Secretary of the Army, Kenneth G. Wickham, Major General, U.S. Army. This was followed by a week of silence. No news, no contact, silence, except for one letter. We received a handwritten letter from my brother Paul, saying how happy he was that we enjoyed the Christmas presents that he had sent home, especially the pajamas and the doll he had for his baby sister. The second telegram was delivered on January 19th, indicating no additional news. The next telegram was delivered on January 27th, confirming my brother's death on January 10th, the date he was initially reported missing. If you search on my brother's name, you will read several accounts of his demise. We learned that his helicopter crashed almost immediately after takeoff due to a malfunctioning tail rotor. There was no need for misleading communications regarding his whereabouts or fatal outcome. Perhaps you can understand the pain and suffering we experienced for weeks before receiving the heartbreaking news that his was in fact a name listed with the fallen. His name is now engraved on the granite which comprises the Vietnam Memorial Wall in Washington, D.C., and also the Vietnam Pillar at our own Central Florida Veterans Memorial in Lake Nona. Thousands of families have received similar messages regarding the fate of their loved ones. Mine is but one story of far too many. When you see the POW-MIA flag, remember to give pause. The flag is ambiguous and implies that those listed as MIA could in fact be held captive. This flag is a constant reminder of the plight of America's unreturned veterans. I am proud to be an American, a citizen of this great country, and I will serve as best I can, albeit not in uniform. The blessings, privileges, and rights experienced in my lifetime will not be taken for granted. The price of freedom is high, to include aching hearts, unanswered questions, bloodshed, and loss of life. The sacrifices made go much deeper than what is immediately visible and can be passed to generations of family members which wait, wanting to learn the fate of their military heroes. I thank you for your time and for permitting me the opportunity to briefly tell my story. Let us remain united in recognizing and honoring all who have served the military of our great nation, including those who are serving today, those who have heard the call of duty and have stood ready and willing to make the ultimate sacrifice. May we never forget that freedom is not free. May God comfort the family of all the heroes we remember today and remind us to keep our POWs and MIAs in our prayers and in our thoughts. May God bless each and every one of you, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie, for sharing your story with us. Now, the University of Central Florida Air Force ROTC Detachment 159 will conduct the table setting ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the front of our gathering. You may have noticed the table set before you. It is filled with symbolism. I will explain. This table is set for our prisoners of war and those missing in action from all wars. Let us remember the United States Army, honored by Cadet Purdy. Let us remember the United States Navy, honored by Cadet Vasquez. Let us remember the United States Marine Corps, honored by Cadet Brutus. Let us remember the United States Coast Guard, honored by Cadet Souls. And let us remember the United States Air Force, honored by Cadet Aurelia. Let us remember the men and women prisoners of war from all branches of service that are too often forgotten. Let us remember them. The tablecloth is white, symbolizing the purity of their intentions to respond to their country's call to arms so that their children could remain free. Remember. The lone candle symbolizes the frailty of a prisoner alone, trying to stand up against his oppressors. Remember. The black ribbon on the candle reminds us of those who will not be coming home. Remember. The single rose reminds us of the loved ones and families of our comrades in arms who keep the faith and await their return. Remember. A slice of lemon is on the plate to remind us of their bitter fate if we do not bring them home. Remember. There is salt on the plate, symbolic of the family's tears as they wait and remember. The glasses are inverted. They cannot toast with us tonight, maybe tomorrow, if we remember. The red ribbon is tied to the flower vase by a yellow ribbon that was worn by thousands who awaited their return. Remember. The faded picture on the table is a reminder that they are missed very much and are remembered by their families. Remember. They are not with us today. Their chairs are tipped, but saved for their hoped return. Let us remember their absence. As you look upon this empty table, do not remember ghosts from our past. Remember our comrades. Remember those whom we depended on in battle. They depend on us to bring them home. Remember our friends. They are the ones we love, who love life and freedom as we do. They will remember what we do. Please honor and remember them.
Many thanks to the UCF Air Force ROTC for their support of this event. It is so important that today and every day we remember our brothers and sisters in uniform who fight bravely to protect our freedoms. It is our duty as Americans to never forget them and to keep our promise to bring them home to their families. Again, thank you for tuning in to this year's virtual POW-MIA recognition ceremony. To learn more about the Advisory Council or get involved, please visit orlando.gov/veterans.